Okay, we will now proceed with the next presentation titled Adaptive Network Modeling on the Influence of Leadership and Communication of Learning within an Organization, that will be presented by Debbie Bowman.
Hi.
Okay, are you ready to share your screen?
Yes, you should be able to see it now, is that correct?
Yes, yeah. Perfect. You have 15 minutes to present, and then there will be 5 minutes for questions from the audience.
All right, perfect. Start. Thank you. So hi, I'm Debbie. This presentation will address the influence of leadership and communication on learning within an organization by direct mutual interactions in the dyads. This is done in combination with multi-level organization as an alternative route, which includes feed-forward and feedback learning. First, we'll start by explaining the multi-level organization learning. The concept of multi-level organizational learning is not new, but the combination with artificial intelligence is still quite new. Organizational learning is a shared knowledge development process involving individuals, groups, and the organization. It occurs firstly through the exchange and formation of shared mental models between team or project members, and secondly, through the institutionalization of these shared mental models on the organizational level for future use. This process is referred to as feed-forward learning, and learning also occurs in the feedback direction when the institutionalized learning and the shared mental models are being transferred and used by teams and individuals. Using computer simulations, we can determine the quickest and most efficient way to share knowledge. And in this research, we will look at 4 different models based on an active and inactive team leader, as well as high or low extent of natural communication. I will start by explaining a little bit of background knowledge. The first step is about mental models, but specifically shared mental models. A mental model represents events and processes from the world and include information we know as well as our beliefs. Through a person's mental manipulation or internal simulation, mental models are capable of understanding and explaining phenomena and thus react appropriately. Mental models rely on 3 assumptions. First being that each mental model represents a possibility. The second is the principle of truth, meaning that the mental model represents what is true according to the premises, but by default not what is false. And lastly, that the deductive reasoning depends on mental models. When working in teams, every person has an individual mental model, but will form a shared mental model. These shared mental models combined with beliefs are important in organizational learning. Next, I will explain a little bit about organizational learning. Humans have the ability to act in groups and through joint actions. And in such joint action, the group creates a set of intersubjective meanings that are expressed in their communication, either verbal or non-verbal or through acts or even objects. Communication includes metaphor, myths, etc. These are shared within the group. New members will initially have little to no idea of the communication within that group, but with time they learn. Organizational learning looks at how people will learn from other people and their experience. In parallel, individuals simultaneously adapt their behavior based on organizational routines and processes. There are 3 observations that form organizational learning. The first being that organizational behavior is based on routines. Secondly, actions made by organizations are often history dependent. And lastly, organizations are oriented to targets. Organizational learning is considered a multi-level phenomenon that involves individuals, teams, and organizations, and the connection between those. This learning process works in feed-forward and feedback directions. Feed-forward learning means that the organizations can learn from individuals and teams, and feedback learning refers to the utilization of already existing and institutionalized knowledge and sharing this with individuals and teams. Features of individual memories have an influence on the organizational learning, and the formation of a shared mental model is usually part of feed-forward organizational learning. The last piece of background information is leadership. there's an established link between leadership and organizational learning. In a study conducted in 1939 by psychologist Kurt Lewin, there were three different styles of leadership identified. I will explain them very shortly. The first being authoritarian. Here, the leadership provides clear instruction of what is needed and expected. The second being participative. Here, the leadership involves a leader who's very involved with the group and involves other members in the decision making, as well as providing guidance when needed. The last leadership identified by Lewin was delegative, and this focuses on delegating initiative to team members. However, recently there were some more leadership styles that have been added, first of which being transformational. In these groups, leaders inspire their followers, and transactional. This is often seen in work environments with an employer and an employee. The employee has the role of a follower in exchange for compensation, often money. So this was all the background information, and now I will describe a real-world scenario on which this paper is based. It is based on a case described by Amy C. Edmondson, which looks at the role of learning within teams, and this is done by observing several teams, and the collective learning process is investigated by looking at the team's reflection and action. In Edmondson's paper, an organization with 12 different teams organized in 5 different team types, and these teams were divided into 3 different groups: 1, reflection and action; 2, reflection without action; and 3, neither reflection nor action. We picked a team called product development team because they had teams in both group 1, which was reflection and action, and team 2, which was reflection without actions. These teams were discussed in depth in Edmondson's paper, and therefore we felt like these would be the most realistic when simulated because we could provide a lot of information without having to assume a lot of things. In this way, the following situation was created. There is a team whose job it is to promote a new product. The relevant team members in the situation are the team leader, which is shortened to TL, the marketing consultant, shortened to M, the designer, shortened to D, and the final representative, shortened to F. The marketing consultant suggests billboard as a way to advertise a new product, while the designer suggests social media. For both ideas, there's money needed from the financial representative. So the team leader suggests that both team members talk to the financial representative. So I hope it's visible clearly. This is the formula for canonical differences, and there are several characteristics in the network model, namely connectivity characteristics. These refer to connections and their weights between states, and they can be seen in this formula, and aggregation characteristics, which calculate the impact from incoming connections, and timing characteristics, which is a speed factor. These two formulas are the functions used in the self-modeling network. Realistic networks models are usually adaptive. This is because both their states and network characteristics change over time. By using a self-modeling or reified network, a similar network model conceptualization can be applied to adaptive networks to obtain a declarative description using mathematically defined functions and relations for them as well. The introduced second-order adaptive network model addresses the effect of communication and leaderships on learning within an organization. Communication can occur by either natural communication or communication organized by the team leader. In this paper, communication is described as communication that happens naturally without extra encouragement from the team leader within the team. Before we started simulating, we made several assumptions, first of which being that the natural communication is either completely off, so low, or completely on, so high. This natural communication can be adjusted for every diet. The second assumption we made is that the level of encouragement from the team leader is also a spectrum. Communication within team members in diets, as well as the relations between team members, can be adjusted by the team leader. Third assumption we made is that there's also a spectrum from feedback and feed-forward learning. Next, we made the assumption that if the team leader states that something will happen, it will happen. This means that nobody overrules the team leader. And last, we assumed that the simulation by the model follows three phases, and these phases do not overlap. The first phase is the natural communication and the team leader interactions. Here, employees are learning by mutual interaction in diets. The second phase is feed-forward learning, and here a shared mental model is formed. And in the last phase, feedback learning is presented. The connectivity can be seen in the following graph. I won't bother you too much with the details because it's, as you can see, it's very overwhelming. So I'll skip to the results. Oh, sorry, scenarios first. We made four different scenarios. The first being the base scenario. Here there was neither an active team leader nor a high level of communication. Our second scenario was an inactive team leader but a high level of communication. The third being an active team leader but a low level of natural communication. And the fourth and last scenario was both an active team leader and a high level of natural communication. Here the simulation results of scenario one can be seen. As you can see, 20 to 60 is the first phase, and you can see that there's no communication here. Thus, there's also no learning. The learning only starts in phase two, which is 60 to 120. As you can see, this learning is only feed-forward organizational learning. Thus, the organization is learning, but the team members are not yet, and the team members only start learning in the learning feedback phase, which is phase three, which is 140 until 180. These are the simulation results of scenario two, which had an inactive team leader, but a high natural communication. And because of this, the team members are already learning during phase one. And in addition, organizational learning happens in phase two, similar to scenario one. However, since the team leader and since the team members have a good communication, the knowledge is already shared. These are the results for scenario three. But similar to scenario two, the team members are already learning in the first phase. This is because the team leader makes sure there's communication within the team. Because of this, the team members are already learning in phase one. And in addition to the information learning by the organization through feed-forward learning in phase two as well. This is the last scenario, scenario four. Comparable to the previous two scenarios, in this scenario, the learning two is happening in phase one. In this case, the communication can happen naturally or through the team leader. This ensures that there's enough communication between the team members to establish a learning process in phase one. In phase two, this knowledge is shared with the organization during the feed-forward learning. And finally, in phase three, the feedback learning is updating the individual mental model as needed. So the results show that when good communication is present, either due to the team leader or due to network communication or both, this can lead to faster learning processes within an organization than the longer route via feed-forward and feedback learning. However, this more direct form of learning in general may take more of the employee's time, as a quadratic number of dyadic interactions in general requires more invested time than a linear number of interactions needed for feed-forward and feedback learning. Learning between team members takes place when there's at least one basis for communication. In the three latter scenarios, the graph was quite similar. They only differ in ways that cannot be seen in these graphs. When there's only an active team leader, this person is often seen as the boss and treated as such. And this team leader is very important because they make sure that everything that needs to get done will be done. However, this can lead to the hierarchical mom effect, which is defined as individuals' reluctance to provide negative feedback to another for fear of being associated with the message. This means that people are less likely to say something to their supervisor, even if it's at the expense of task accomplishments, because they want to maintain a positive relationship. This can be seen specifically in work relationships. Another factor is that team members are more likely to expect negative feedback from their team leader than the team leader expects negative feedback from them. This may negatively influence other people, team members, to expressing their negative opinion. Other research has shown that when there is a two-way symmetrical communication system, which also includes internal team peer communication, the likelihood of an employee's job satisfaction increases as well as their participation and commitment. Internal communication helps team leader connect with their members and thus help the organization with bettering its environment. So the presence of an active team leader as well as network communication leads to a more satisfactory work experience. When there's only a high level of network communication, team members may learn a lot from each other, but things could still be missing. Like mentioned before, a team leader is important because they ensure that everything that needs to be done will be done. When this responsible person is missing, it could be that some things are missed or stay undecided. Thus, even though the three latter scenarios had to an extent the same outcome, there still could be differences that are not shown in the graph. The result of this being a computational model leads to the fact that it does not fully cover reality. There might be other factors important in an organization that might influence learning processes. Examples of this are the amount of people in an organization, the relationship for each individual diet, the type of project they're working on, the list goes on and on. It's not suitable to create a real life experiment of this. This is because some scenarios, like an inactive team leader and low network communication, could lead to hostile work environments. And for further research, differentiation within a scenario could be made. For example, two communications have a high level of natural communication between them, but not with another coworker. However, for the sake of simplicity, this was not addressed yet. Further research could also look at larger teams or more layers within the team. This was everything that I said in my paper. Are there any questions?
For the presentation, I will now proceed to questions from the audience. If anyone has a question, please raise your hand. No, I have a question.
Hi. I was wondering if your model can give us, for example, for management science, an idea of what is the best kind of leadership in terms of efficiency? For example, if you could model different kinds of leadership and see the productivity that can happen depending on the leadership that you impose, do you think that your modeling could provide this kind of hint for management science?
Thank you for the question. This is actually something we did think about a little. As can be seen in the scenarios, I did mention some leadership styles here. For example, the inactive team leader and a high natural communication could be because the team leader is very delegative and trusts their team to make the right decisions without them. So it could be that the team leader just at the start of the project says, "Hi everyone, good luck, goodbye," and leaves it to them without taking too much of an authoritarian leadership role, which can be seen in an active team leader, but in low natural communication. This is, in my opinion, usually a transactional or authoritarian leadership because every team member can just get their task and just do it without having the need to communicate with other team members. This could be, for example, in the scenario where there's a new team with an already experienced team leader. And in scenario 4, where there's both an active team leader and a high natural communication, I thought that was most likely linked with participative or transformational leadership, because in those two types of leaderships, the leader is actually really enthusiastic and involved in the project. which I think could naturally lead to a higher natural communication. And this could be, for example, when team members and team leaders are familiar with each other already and feel more comfortable. And in scenario one, when there's neither an active team leader nor high natural communication, I don't think that fits any leadership, but we had to put it in as a baseline.
But do you think this kind of leadership is 35% better than the other one, or numerically giving the influence of leadership in the final productivity that the team will exhibit?
Yeah, that could be. But in order to do that, I think our simulation has to be way more detailed, and we didn't, unfortunately, have the time for that. So it's very simplified, which why I think there is not a lot of differences that can be seen in the graphs. But I think it's definitely possible if the models are less simplified.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for your question.
Any other questions? There seems to be no more questions. So this concludes the presentation of this blog and day. Thanks to all the presenters and to all members of the all presenters for the audience. Activities will resume tomorrow according to the schedule. Thank you very much to everyone.